It's a common sight. Girls lacing up their skates to hit the ice and play hockey. Most don't know there was a time when many girls weren't allowed to play hockey, soccer, or baseball. Over the last half century, much has changed for women in sport in Canada. Canadian women athletes are victorious on the elite international stage. Girls are signing up for more sports in larger numbers. And yes, they play hockey.
When I started watching the national team in 1990, there was 10,000 girls and women playing, and now there's close to 100,000 girls and women playing in this country. I grew up wanting to play for the Edmonton Oilers and played in the NHL. That's all I knew when I was a little girl, and no one told me differently. It was, you know, wonderful and pure. It was also, at times, very difficult. I probably experienced every form of sort of verbal, emotional abuse that's out there that you could go through as a young girl. I think it's very different today for young girls playing hockey. I think everything is a little better for women in sport. I think women in sport has a long way to go.
Women are just as powerful, we're just as strong. We're just as good. We're gonna do it in a different way than a man would. It's realizing those differences and embracing those instead of realizing that there are differences and it makes you a weaker sex.
We've gone from a point where women only were encouraged to do, say, gymnastics or do skating or do something with grace and style, and now we're including the idea of women doing boxing in the Olympics. Like, ooh, look at how far we've come, right? Which is good, but now we can do even more.
The surprise came when after 3 months of hockey, someone checked Ab's birth certificate and found that Ab was short for Abigail.
The articulated norm was girls play with dolls, they aspire to get married, they do feminine things, they don't, by and large, put on boys' hockey skates and boys' hockey equipment and pick up a boys' hockey stick and go out and play competitive sports with boys.
It was 1956 and 9-year-old Abigail Hoffman wanted to play hockey. She knew there were no girls' teams in Toronto, but she still convinced her parents to take her to Varsity Arena, where she joined the throng of boys waiting to register.
I told them my name was Ab Hoffman, which was partly true. That's what it said on my hockey stick. Showed them my birth certificate, and I didn't kind of consciously put my finger over the sex part.
Young Ab Hoffman became a good defenseman and was chosen for the All-Star team. But this time, she was asked to hand over her birth certificate.
I said, what the heck, this Ab Hoffman person, whose name on my birth certificate says actually Abigail Golda Hoffman. The story all broke from there, and it became quite a cause célèbre.
What was your reaction?
Well, I was absolutely amazed. I just didn't believe it possible that we had a little girl amongst 400 boys in our league.
It's rather funny when I think of the number of times I shouted to her to skate that fellow into the board.
I've kind of lived with that notoriety now my entire life, and all I wanted to do was just play hockey.
What do you think of all this fuss that's been created about you?
I think it's a lot of nonsense.
At the end of the season, Abby was told the league had put a rule in place banning all girls from playing hockey. She instead joined track and field and went on to win Pan Am gold and represent Canada in 4 Olympic Games, even while continuing to chafe against the many restrictions she and her fellow female athletes faced. Sports were too dangerous for women, they were told. They were too frail for physical exertion. They were going to crush their ovaries if they ran too far or too fast.
People don't think that running 50 miles a week is a good idea for girls. Guess what? I'm going to run 60.
Abby Hoffman became one of the most influential women in sport in Canada, a brilliant policymaker and the first female director general of Sport Canada. She, along with other athletes and activists, pushed, demanded, and fought tirelessly to make sport a better place for women.
And, you know, there was a certain amount of, you know, theater involved as well.
You are watching The Great Debate, with Abby Hoffman taking the affirmative and Alan Eagleson the negative on our resolution that sport is a masculine right. Pierre Burton is our chairman.
Well, in order to be good at track and field, say, or volleyball, you need to do a certain amount of weight training for strength. Mm-hmm. And the reaction is immediately,
I don't want any part of it.
I don't want to be strong.
Keep me beautiful.
Yep. And I'm saying
well,
that
it's more than strength. I think the reaction is one that the young girl said, look, I think I'd rather just be pretty and be able to,
yeah, but
to
where
run
does
fast
that
without
kind
building
of image
up my
come
muscles.
From? Where does that sort of self-image come from?
Well, it's a reflection of our society.
That's my point.
But the point is,
and I don't know how effective any of these things were as single individual measures, but cumulatively, they mobilized a lot of people to pay attention. They mobilized a lot of women to sort of say, yeah, you know what? These people may be crazy, but they're doesn't mean they're wrong. They're crazy and they're right.
As a joke, we drew something, we call it a scrotum clamp, and then we'd look at it before we go in and say, okay, we're going to take this in our minds while we're talking to the men, and we're going to say, okay, do you want to use the scrotum clamp or not? Gotta think about it. Anyway, but it was that kind of time where it was just so confrontational.
World record holder, Olympic medalist, Commonwealth Games champion, and decorated activist Marion Leigh has dedicated her life to fighting discrimination against women in sport, something she first became aware of after winning bronze in the 1968 Summer Olympics.
I just made the assumption everybody, all girls and women, could play their sport and get to the Olympic levels. So when I was there, I just realized only 28% of the sports back then that women could even compete in. I realized that there was a group of white males that owned sport, whether it was professional sport or amateur sport, and that it was only if father agreed that they would allow you to participate or be part of their game.
Marion joined a group of like-minded athletes intent on making sport better for women. In 1974, she, along with Abby Hoffman and Petra Burka, organized a national conference to address these concerns. Marion went on to manage the Women in Sport program in Canada and continued to speak about how poorly women were represented in sport, the little funding they received and the few resources they could access. Despite her efforts, she didn't get much support even from those in the growing women's movement.
Do you hate men? Is that why you're saying these things? They didn't see the discrimination. They just thought it's the tradition in sport. So anybody that says to me, you know, we have to remember the tradition in sport, I just automatically think, yeah, discrimination. That's what you have to remember. Like, I just thought, how could this be? I don't know why. I just thought, it's play. It's sport. Why wouldn't we want everyone to play and be involved in sport?
In 1981, a group of activists established the Canadian Association for the Advancement of Women in Sport, to advocate for progressive change in Canada's sports system.
CAUSE started to look at workshops, looking around the world for best practices, bringing new examples, getting a whole diverse group of men and women involved in the workshops. We had older women, younger women, trying to get some money for research. So we were starting to make inroads that way, but little did I know how slow it was going to be. I really didn't think it would be my life's work. I really did think it would be changed. You start to laugh nowadays, you just kind of think, oh my God, are we there again?
You're lucky there's not a vibrator in here, like in England.
And just where are we? Today we have much to celebrate in Canada. Our female athletes are among the best in the world. Sport is better for women and girls. But is it good enough? 50 years after Abby Hoffman was barred from playing her sport, a group of women were once again being told they weren't allowed to compete.
Just as a kid, I was always kind of jumping off things or climbing things. And I just loved it right from the beginning. I think the first time it really dawned on me that, you know, maybe this was going to be a challenge with women's ski jumping not being in the Olympics. I was the only girl on that team, and I remember our coach gave us the selection for who he was bringing to Europe that summer. I wasn't able to go because they were just going to men's ski jumping competitions, and they weren't going to go to any for me.
In 1991, the IOC declared that all new Olympic sports must feature events for women. But ski jumping, one of the original 8 Winter Olympic events, escape this requirement. Repeated attempts to convince the IOC to include the event first in 2002 and then in 2006 failed.
We were told by the head of the FIS that it was dangerous for women to ski jump because I think in the quote you said it's like jumping 2 meters down 1,000 times a year. It wouldn't be safe for their ovaries or something like that. And it's just, it was more like humiliating.
Kaillie Willis and her mother filed a human rights complaint, targeting the federal government for providing public funds to the Vancouver Games.
We were just trying to present that, you know, this is a case of gender discrimination, and under the charter, we shouldn't be able to see this happening in Canada. When it was accepted, the human rights complaint, that we did have some hope that it was going to be the changing point for us. But of course, you know, there's always a few stepping stones. So this was our first one.
When the human rights complaint didn't produce results, Kaillie decided to join the lawsuit launched against the Vancouver Olympic Organizing Committee, but not without some concern.
Bringing the lawsuit was a little controversial for us because we were worried that we were going to make too much noise and in that sense be punished for it. And I think that's exactly what came out from Dick Pound, who was on the IOC. He said that, you know, because we're embarrassing the IOC with this lawsuit, that maybe we will have to wait another 4 or 8 years. And I think that's what scared some people from joining it. But in the end, I think it was necessary to do that just to get our voice out there.
The judge, while agreeing the IOC was discriminating against the women, ultimately dismissed the suit, declaring the IOC was neither subject to the jurisdiction of the court nor governed by Canada's Charter of Rights and Freedoms.
It was very heartbreaking because we had to walk out there and face the media, and, you know, we were upset, we were crying, and, you know, this is your dream, you know, being shattered.
The judge said there is discrimination within the IOC, so that was a real win. And I think they've just come up with their 40 new recommendations, and gender is there, and they realize that women's events, they have to get them equal. No sport can get in the games now without equal men, male and female, and that's been for the last few years, but they have to figure out how to catch up. They just can't grandfather, as they would say, in discrimination. So right after that, women's ski jumping got funding from Sport Canada, they got a coach, and so it really changed, and they were basically guaranteed a spot in Sochi going forward, right?
But for Kaillie, the victory came too late. Having already deferred university for a year with the hope she'd compete in Vancouver, she quit the sport to continue her education.
A lot of people ask me if it was kind of bittersweet, and I think it was, you know. I mean, I wish it could have been, you know, in my time, and that would have been for 2010. I love the sport, and just that feeling of going off the jump and flying was everything for me. I'm so happy that I was a part of pioneering this and that it is now in the Olympics, and I can be proud to say that I was there to help.
With the inclusion of ski jumping in the Sochi Olympics, women now compete in the same sports as men. But there's still fewer female athletes competing in fewer events, both at the Summer and Winter Olympics. Women are still being banned from longer races and harder events. In Canada, we have a long history of women turning to the courts to fight for the right to access sports. In 1981, 10-year-old Justine Blaney won a spot on her local hockey team, but the league told her girls couldn't play. She challenged them before the Ontario Human Rights Commission, but lost because the province's human rights code allowed gender discrimination in sports. In 1987, after enduring 5 different court cases, her fight went to the Supreme Court of Canada, which found that rules prohibiting women from playing in men's leagues were in violation of the charter. 10 years later, twin sisters Jessie and Amy Pasternak complained to the Manitoba Human Rights Commission when their high school wouldn't let them try out for the senior boys' hockey team. With the precedent set by Justine's case, the Pasternaks were successful in challenging the discriminatory rule. While the courts may be one avenue for women to gain access to sporting events, in 2014, world champion bobsleigh racer Kaillie Humphries took matters into her own hands.
From day one in bobsleigh, I always thought it was wrong that guys got 2 foremen and girls didn't. I mean, it's the way that the sport has always been. I didn't like it, but I conformed to it. But now I'm at a point, you know, 8 years in, this is gonna be my 9th year as a pilot. I need new challenges. I need to push the limits of what I'm able to do. Four men really allows me and my driving skill within the sport to do that, and that's why I've really pushed for it. Also at the same point, you know, I want women to have four men. I was aware that it was going to be a battle that I assumed was going to take like 20 years. No joke. I thought for sure I was going to be fighting and fighting. One of my coaches specifically told me 3 years ago, I remember sitting at a table in Austria, he was like, man, I'll die before the day I see women do four men. And he's like, I'd quit. Like, no joke. And I'm like, you are kind of a dick. But at the same point, he's a coach and there's so much experience that he knows. But that's what I'm working with. I was naive to think that I could be not on an equal level. I still feel like I can be on an equal level, but I was naive to think that I could operate in the exact same system that they can. I have the support that I need from other coaches, from my family, and from different organizations, you know, that believe that, you know, women are champions and you can really do anything you set your mind to. And then there's going to be the doubters and the haters that say no. And so I plan to go out and, you know, break down those stereotypes the very best that I can.
A personal triumph for Kaillie became a symbol of women's progression in sport. But is this what we've been fighting for this whole time? When women compete with men, is this equity in the world of sport or is it equality? What is the difference between the two?
Equality or full equality would mean simply that people are being treated the same way, with the same opportunity, the same ability to enter into a particular team or sport. Equitable treatment sometimes means that you have to redress what has been happening in the past that hasn't been really appropriate. And it may also mean that you have to give some groups of people maybe a different set of rules or a different kind of equipment in order to be able to play.
Sarah, back up, look, over there.
For one recreational soccer league, equity means ensuring girls have their own spaces to play.
The league was actually all entirely co-ed, so it was from 4 years old to 13 years old, and all the way through it was co-ed, which I thought was just insane. At the beginning of the season, they were all pretty into it. They were all pretty excited to be out there for soccer. By the end of the season, we were having to force the girls onto the field, and only the most elite little athletes were still in there and still trying. Most of them were just standing around or crying, didn't want to go on the field. And I actually had one girl never once touch the ball in the whole time she was ever coming out. We switched it into boys and girls, and all of a sudden she was touching the ball 10, 15 times a game. She was having so much fun, and she was part of it, and she was looking forward to it, and she was playing soccer, which was so great. And this is why I did this, for like the average person who's probably never, she might not even make a team in high school, but she was actually playing soccer and having fun with her friends, and just what a positive difference it was.
Whether girls and women require their own space in sport, or athletes of likability compete regardless of gender, it's a debate that will be ongoing. But when it comes to determining gender in sport, the controversy heats up.
These issues, of course, are central to sport and performance because if somebody has certain features like strength or muscle mass or hormone levels, they may be stronger than other people. And so consequently, issues such as gender testing, which is still going on, at the Olympic level and at some Commonwealth Games level, is very, very controversial.
I did not know that I was going to be facing gender testing. Somebody came and took a swab, and that was the end of it. And a day later, there was something posted that said all of these women have passed, and from then on, I was able to compete. But I have my card. It's a femininity card, which pleases my mother enormously.
Sandra Kirby is an Olympic rower, an academic, and a key figure in the international women and sport movement. When she competed in the 1976 Summer Olympics, she, like every other female athlete, had to submit to a test to verify her gender.
The process used to be kind of pull out your track pants and look down to see whether you had the right genitalia. So that was just prior to my time. By the time I was there, it was the swab.
Scientific gender tests for women were introduced in the 1960s, but as far back as the 1930s, medical professionals were asked to provide an objective judgment of an athlete's gender. the need to safeguard against men competing in women's events explain this violation, even though there has been only one documented case in the 1936 Olympics when German high jumper Dora Ratchian was discovered to be a man. In response to growing public outrage, the program was shelved in 2000. Not long after, it was replaced with another kind of testing, this one for hypoandrogenism, measuring a female athlete's natural testosterone. The IOC and IAAF say high levels of natural androgen give competitors an unfair advantage. Administered only to women, the test is as controversial as its predecessor.
It's the worst kind of moral physiology, patriarchal prohibitions masquerading as science that I've seen in a very, very long time. We can cite reams of science that concludes that there's no correlation between natural testosterone in women and performance.
If we're saying this is a genetic advantage, how do you test men for those men that have androgen that's way above the norm? Are they tested and you're made into a separate category? No, they aren't tested. So where are we going and why is this only for women?
In the 2014 Commonwealth Games in Glasgow, Duti Chan, a runner from India, was barred from competing because she failed the hypoandrogenism test. She was given a choice: undergo hormone therapy or invasive surgery to lower her natural testosterone, or quit the sport. Duti decided to fight.
This is a historic test case. We are hopeful but not confident that it will go well, and if we're successful, it'll change international sport for girls and women forever. Well, I'm enraged by it. I'm sickened by it. I think it's nuts. I think it's unfair. I think it's sexist. I think it's brutal.
I think it has a whole lot to do with women need to look like women for the TV, and men need to look like men. In the 1960s, there was a whole lot of TV coverage in sport that was, it was really emerging. And we had some star athletes out of Russia who looked like refrigerators, you know, women who are big, blocky women. And that didn't go very well. So I think there was some kind of testing to make sure, you know, these really are women. The girl next door is really the image that the TV wanted.
They were tough, ambitious, accomplished athletes, but they were always belittled, although very cleverly, as being sweethearts, like Barbara Ann Scott or Marilyn Bell. Clearly, even the best athletes were expected to be soft, to be attractive, to be, quote, feminine, and to not challenge patriarchal dominance.
I remember, you know, Marilyn Bell swims across Lake Ontario, this phenomenal swim. She does something that no male or female has ever done before. But the way she was kind of, I don't even want to say trivialized, almost infantilized. But it was almost as if, you know, we'll do almost anything we can to not talk about the athleticism or the courage or the determination or the pure physical fortitude that Marilyn Bell obviously brought to both her training and actually making this swim.
Today, the media is more likely to show female athletes not so much as the weaker sex than the sexier sex.
Alors que l'athlète masculin, les autres gars, ils le regardent, disent wow, that's what I want to be, je veux ces pecs-là, je veux ces abdos-là. Alors les hommes vont s'identifier parce que ça représente la puissance, c'est ce que ces images-là font ressortir. Du côté des femmes, là, on ressort aucune qualité athlétique. Là. On dit pas « wow, elle est forte cette athlète-là », on dit non « wow, elle est belle, sexy, là, t'sais, c'est hot ».
The implied question here was and is how feminine is a strong, muscular female athlete?
Yeah, for sure. I wrestled with feeling feminine when I was an athlete, absolutely. All this weightlifting was going to ruin our figures. You know, and that was just the reality that back in the 70s, right, was that like muscles might not be attractive and that you could get too muscular and that was going to change your figure, actually ruin your figure. And I think I carried that with me for quite a long time. when I think back to the kinds of sports that were covered when I was growing up, it was always like the tennis players, and there was the whole Martina Navratilova, Chris Evert. Chris was the cute, smiley one. Martina was more muscular, and sort of people would describe her as manlike in her build. And the girl next door against this sort of muscular, more masculine version of women.
At the 2015 Australian Open, Canadian Eugenie Bouchard beat her opponent Kiki Bertens in two straight sets. Courtside, a reporter asked her to twirl and show her outfit.
I literally wanted to throw the TV out the window. Like, I just, if we have an athlete who's at the top of her game and blasted into the top 10, and the first thing that a sportcaster can say, can you show us your outfit?
Les gens banalisent ça. C'est comme, ah, tu sais, c'est pas grave, y a rien là. Mais non, c'est grave. Et tout cet aspect-là de l'athlète est complètement mis de côté. Et là, on focus sur sa sexualité. Mais non, mais c'est quoi le message qu'on envoie derrière ça? Une athlète, je suis un corps de femme, un objet.
When we started the Canadian Association for the Advancement of Women in Sport in 1981, that was one of the first things we were trying to do, was change the approach of the media to women's bodies. Because you would see, you know, the peak of breast or the crotch shot. You would never see the execution of the shot or the performance. So for somebody to be on a sport court and say, give us a twirl and let's see how you look, it just makes me feel that there has been zero progress in that front in 30 years. And that's so unfortunate.
In sport, like the rest of society, sex sells. But in sport in particular, is there something else at play? Women in sport can either be sexualized or find it's their sexual orientation that comes into question.
En fait, dans notre société, le sport, c'est encore masculin et toutes les qualités athlétiques qui sont associées, la puissance, la force, l'agressivité, c'est masculin. Et là, maintenant qu'on commence à avoir des athlètes féminines qui sont extrêmement douées, qui sont puissantes, qui sont agressives, qui veulent gagner aussi, qui sont fortes. Mais là, c'est comme ça, féminin, avec ces qualités-là, ça concorde pas, ça marche pas. Donc, tu dois pas être une vraie femme, égale, tu dois être une lesbienne.
At some level, everybody expects if you're strong and you're aggressive, and you're successful in sport and you're female, you must be lesbian.
Women athletes and coaches have good reason to be concerned about the lesbian label. It has been enough to ruin careers. Betty Baxter was the captain of the 1976 Olympic volleyball team before being appointed the first woman head coach in Canada. And then the rumors began.
So it's summer of 1981. I've been the coach for about 12, 14 months. One day the technical director at the time asks, can he speak to me for a minute? So I go into the office with him. He says, close the door. And he said, I just want you to know that some of my best friends are gay, but there's a lot of talk. You need to know that there's rumors about you.
Betty's sexual orientation had become the stuff of speculation.
The director from BC comes out and stops me in the hallway, pulls me off to the corner and says, you're in real trouble. They're talking that athletes are sleeping together, that they can't get their training done because they're having sex with each other, and that you need to be dismissed. I go to the Volleyball Association. I'm fired for no cause. I lose the job that I had basically worked for 12 years. So that, for me, was like having my legs cut off. It was like just being thrown away.
While 35 years ago may seem like ancient history, in 2015, head coach Shannon Miller was fired after 16 seasons and a record 5 national championships with the University of Minnesota Duluth women's hockey team. She is fighting back, claiming discrimination against her gender and sexual orientation. Understandable then when 4-time Olympic gold medal hockey player Charline Labonté came out. She did so with great care and some trepidation.
Everyone's been asking, how come no women hockey players have come out? And, you know, who's going to be the first one to do it? And I knew there was a need there, and I was hoping that someone was going to do it. Because I never thought it would be me. But then, prior to Sochi, with the new anti-gay laws that came out, obviously I didn't agree with them, and a lot of people didn't. And a lot of people said, you know, are you gonna do something at the games? So for me, I following the games, I'm like, okay, I have 4 gold medals right now, we have the visibility, let's do something about it. When you decide to come out, yeah, of course it's, I was scared. When I did it, I realized that it's so hard to put yourself out there. And, you know, if people think of me, I'm Chandler Molte, I'm a goalie and I'm an athlete. And that's generally the idea of me. But now when people will think of me, of course it's gonna be, it's Chandler Molte, she's a goalie, she's a hockey player, and she's gay. But I feel like people might be scared of that and to be identified right away. If you Google, that's the first thing that comes up. When it went out on social media in that afternoon and I turned on my phone and I was getting an overwhelming amount of positive messages through emails or Facebook. And it was like way, way above anything that I expected. The biggest part was coming from letters coming from young kids that are struggling or going through what I did 10 years ago. And, you know, they're about 18, 19 in the closet and they tell you, I read your letter and because of you today, I'm gonna come out to my parents. And I mean, how can that not be worth it?
Okay, des lesbiennes ou pas, ces femmes-là, c'est des super athlètes. Alors, qu'est-ce que leur orientation sexuelle a à faire là-dedans? Rien, rien, rien. Alors, c'est des bonnes athlètes, c'est des bonnes athlètes, c'est tout. Mais parce qu'encore une fois, on n'est pas capable d'apprécier la performance des athlètes pour ce qu'elle est, bien, on trouve des façons de dénigrer et tout de suite, on va les associer au lesbianisme. Et ça, pour moi, c'est vraiment dommage.
The female athlete as lesbian or the female athlete as sex symbol. Both representations diminish athletic achievements. But it's not just how the media represents female athletes. The other question is how much.
Quand on parle de femmes et médias, sportives et médias, ben en fait, pour moi, le premier mot qui vient, c'est invisible. On n'est pas là. Et ce qui est, pour moi, le plus dérangeant, c'est que les gens s'en rendent même pas compte.
Recent studies show that women's sports receive a mere 3.2% of television coverage. Even more alarming, that figure has dropped from 8.7% in 1999.
Television is very expensive. It's very resource heavy. It requires a lot of people, a lot of equipment. And as a private broadcaster, it's supported by ad revenue. So if the ad revenue isn't there, then unfortunately it's not sustainable. I mean, advertisers have limited amount of dollars and they make their decision on where they're going to put those dollars on numerous factors. Ratings is one of them, particularly in the broadcast world, they're buying an audience. If you can't deliver that audience, it's very difficult to make a value equation for them. So, you know, chicken and egg, if we show more, will they view more?
Pour moi, c'est une règle de base en marketing. Si on veut vendre un produit, qu'est-ce qu'on fait? On le montre, on le montre, on le montre, on le montre. Et là, les gens disent, ah, ben finalement, j'en ai besoin. Mais c'est la même chose pour le sport féminin.
Certainly, there's an audience to be built there, but it does take time to build it.
The talk should be about rebuilding the audience. Not many people know it, but at one time in Canada, the audience for women's sports was greater than men's.
As a flowering of first wave feminism, and the changes brought about in the First World War, women entered every sport imaginable and excelled at those sports. Hard to believe, but more Torontonians paid to watch women play softball in the 1920s and 1930s, some years, than paid to watch men play professional baseball. Most newspapers had women who covered those sports, and they attracted huge followings. And the women on those teams were household words.
When the Depression hit and resources became scarce, these female sporting teams folded. Sport became an entirely masculine realm, and not by accident.
You can date the the de-emphasis of women on the sports page, in the radio broadcasts, from that realization that sports is the way to sell those products that manufacturers want to sell to men. And so forget about women, use men's sport as a way to attract. Ever since they discovered that, the mass media has toned down or reduced the coverage of women and masculinized the coverage of male sport. And you can date that to the late 1930s.
So if an entire age of women in sport can be erased from lack of media coverage, what does that say about the issue today?
It's important for women to know that it doesn't always have to be this way. When you look at women's sports in Canada, we can see that. Women had their own organizations in the 20s and 30s. Women had significantly more media coverage in the 20s and 30s than they do today. It can be different, and if you don't fight to maintain and strengthen it, it can disappear or be weakened.
Si c'est important qu'on voit du sport masculin, il y a une raison derrière ça, et c'est pourquoi c'est justement pour intéresser les garçons à faire du sport, à avoir des idoles, à avoir un but, à dire ah oui, moi c'est ça que je veux faire, j'ai accès, c'est quelque chose de possible. Mais pourquoi tous ces rêves-là, ces modèles-là qu'on offre aux garçons?
Why do most boys continue to play hockey? Because they're going to make the NHL. They're going to grow up and they're going to play for a team that they've adored, that they love, and they're going to make money. And so for us, we're trying to create the same thing. So it's like, you know, when the professional league becomes, you know, more widely known and more people start to follow us, young little girls are going to say, wow, I didn't know I could grow up and earn a career. Well, of course I'm going to join hockey.
Seeing female athletes in the media provides role models and inspiration, but it's also about marketing and money.
Every 4 years, you know, the Olympics comes around, and I think last year 13.1 million individuals, you know, watched that final game. And I don't think there was one out of the 13.1 million that didn't say it was absolutely outstanding game of hockey. And so for us, it's to say, why don't you watch us after it's over? Do you not know we're alive? Do you not know where we play? And so that's a huge challenge for us.
The Canadian Women's Hockey League is the NHL equivalent for women, with one important distinction. The average NHL player draws an annual salary of $2.8 million. This year, the women players of CWHL each made $1,000. But even this small amount is a step forward.
Even 2 years ago, we used to have to pay at least $1,000 or $1,500 a year. Just to cover the cost, the different costs that a team can have. So, you know, traveling, the roads, staying in hotel, the bus, the food. And this didn't include our equipment or anything like that. So at least now we're at a point where everything is covered, but now we still have to pay for equipment.
Is our plan to pay the players? Absolutely. But before you pay the players, you have to create everything around it so that when we pay our players, that it continues to pay them, it continues to grow. So more fans in the stands brings more sponsors. More sponsors bring more money. More money brings more pay equity for the players.
That brand and that style of hockey, there is a market for. What I think is difficult is to convince executives in television, in corporate Canada, corporate US, to step up and invest, and why it's not just a charity give, why there's actually an economic reason to invest in women in sport. Preparing a family of four to pay $100 to watch a women's game, so they're going to pay $400, $500, $600 to watch an NHL game. You know, that's the buy-in there. Really, it's about television ratings, it's about bums in seats, and it's about that interest in the game. And everybody has to sort of take a collective role in helping to develop that, not just the players on the ice. I say that every time I talk to somebody, it'll happen, and you know, in the next few years, and it doesn't. And now I'm feeling impatient because it needs to happen. And I think we're right on the cusp of it happening, whether it's going to be in my playing days or not, I don't know.
I think there's a massive responsibility that the media has to take on that says, yeah, you know, we should be writing these articles about these phenomenal women. We should be writing articles that, you know, that young kids can look up to and say, wow, I didn't know that women could do that.
It's not just hockey that craves both media attention and financial investment. With few exceptions, professional female athletes have access to a fraction of the money their male counterparts earn when it comes to pay, funding, and scholarships.
As early as 98, women within the sport of bobsleigh, and a lot of them now are my coaching staff, used to get detergent as prizes. Bottles of dishwashing liquid of Tide and, you know, ironing boards, no joke, dead serious. Women also have a huge disadvantage when it comes to sponsorship dollars within sport as well. You know, we make up 4% of all sponsorship dollars that are out there. That's a huge disadvantage. 96% go to men. I hope the sponsorship dollars ends up equal. 50-50. You know, I'd be happy with 60-40, but like 96-4, that's a big difference.
Professional female athletes struggle with lower pay and funding. But even at the community levels, lack of financial support can limit how much girls participate in sport. For daughters of new Canadians, there can be an added cultural barrier that their brothers might not have to face. If sport for girls has no perceived value, parents might be more likely to focus solely on education.
When you have parents who are immigrants, they've given up a lot to get here. So extra money to like be involved in sports isn't necessarily like the highest on their list of priorities. I never did organized sports until I was almost 18. And that's when I actually was discovered working at McDonald's.
Nicole Forrester is an Olympian, a 2010 Commonwealth Games gold medalist and an 8-time Canadian champion. Her 6'3" height caught the attention of a Toronto coach who saw the makings of a champion high jumper. The talk turned quickly to scholarship opportunities.
Who knew that people gave you like a free education for jumping over a stick, right? I told my parents and they liked the idea because they're like, free education? Yeah.
Nicole accepted an offer from the University of Michigan. Unlike Canada, American universities are governed by Title IX, a law passed in 1972 that requires gender equity for boys and girls in every educational program that receives federal funding.
At Michigan, before Title IX, there was a track team, but it was not a varsity team. And so Title IX forced track, along with other sports, to become a varsity sport for the university and to provide those scholarships. I had the resources, I had the facility, I had to want for nothing. All I had to do was show up and train. In Canada, when that comes to a post-secondary institution, oftentimes it might be a women's sport that gets cut, like a women's hockey team. And why is it that the men's hockey team isn't cut as well?
While scholarships are awarded to female athletes in Canada, there is disparity in funding between university women's and men's teams. Hockey player Michelle Palouk is grateful for her scholarship. She just wishes she had some of the fringe benefits her male counterparts enjoy.
They definitely just have more resources that come into their program. I think a lot of it comes from alumni, actually, that have been through the program, but instead of donating to hockey at the U of M, they donate to men's hockey at the U of M. And even scholarship-wise, we are fortunate to have some scholarships here with the program, but there's obviously way more for the men's team. There's no comparison in the resources that we get and the men's team gets. We live in the 21st century. There shouldn't be such a divide between the men and women's program at each university, but there is.
It's clear that female athletes continue to be significantly undervalued financially and in the media. With media coverage of women's sports being cut, what can be done?
When you have a newsroom full of men, their viewpoint is going to be a male viewpoint. And I think the more we can ensure that females are represented, not just on the playing field, but in the broadcast booth and at the editorial table and at the executive level, to make sure that that voice is heard. It's why I wanted to be at the table. It's why I asked to be at the table, so that I could try and affect some change, because that's where change happens.
Making change for women in sport requires strong leadership in governing bodies, funding agencies, and on the field. The question is, where are all the women?
We have a real lack of female coaches in this country. And, you know, you look at any Olympic team and the number of female coaches that were just underrepresented in a big way. And also having women in positions of power.
Mais lorsqu'on regarde encore qui prend les décisions en sport, et les femmes ne sont pas là. Donc les personnes qui décident à quoi va ressembler le sport, quelle vision, quelle direction on va lui donner, la voix des femmes n'est pas entendue.
There's been some very talented women who have tried to break into the system and have been unsuccessful.
Ils sont souvent isolées, ils n'ont pas de soutien. Et là, elles doivent se battre constamment. Puis souvent, quand on regarde les ressources qui sont données à l'équipe féminine, l'équipe masculine, aux athlètes masculins, féminins, dans certains sports, il y a vraiment une disparité.
When you have little kids, that's almost an insurmountable obstacle unless the sport organization and the sport body, you know, embraces the concept that kids sometimes come with mom. And this is not new to sport. It's not new really to any career.
Alors là, les coachs féminins sont là encore pour se battre, demander. Puis à un moment donné, ils disent bye, je m'en vais. Fini, niet. Le sport n'est pas accueillant, ne veut pas changer.
Tackler. Every single situation.
There was a point in time where I was coaching the under-19 Ontario team, the under-19 national team, the Western team, playing for Rugby Canada and somehow being the administrator for Rugby Ontario and the women's programs. But that's what I did. I just was full on into rugby.
Natasha Wesch has played and coached rugby since high school. In 2009, she was offered the position of head coach for the National Women's Sevens program. Her target was the World Cup in Dubai, the first time the women's sevens would play in the same tournament as the men's.
And when we got to our first tournament, which was the USA Sevens, pretty big deal, we won the whole thing. It's funny because Rugby Canada really didn't pay attention to me for the first year. But then when we started winning, you know, people were like, oh my God, you're winning. Oh, well, we can do this and we can do that. And people from Rugby Canada would come and watch our games. They didn't do that before. So now all of a sudden, again, more interest, more interest into what was happening, but not any more support.
At the World Cup, Natasha and her team placed sixth after a tough game with a high-ranked and well-funded team from England. Then came the announcement.
Now, for the first time in at least everybody's lifetime here, we could go to the Olympics. And so everybody involved wanted to go to the Olympics. They want to coach the team, and all the guys at Rugby Canada who wanted to go, this was a perfect opportunity.
Eager to move forward, Natasha planned to meet with Rugby Canada to debrief and talk next steps.
What happened was I ended up meeting with the high performance director who said, essentially, we had made a mistake in selecting you. We're going to move on with somebody else, and if you want to be involved with Rugby Canada, you can come back and be an apprentice coach with our junior programs, which I had coached head coach for over 6 years on my own. It was unbelievable the way that it had ended. You know, had they said, you know what, we need more coaches involved, we'd love for you to bring in, and let's make sure that we can use all the knowledge that you've gained over the past 10 years coaching these women and being involved with them and help them take this program to the next level. But that wasn't done. It was, thanks very much, see you later. We made a mistake. You need to get out of our hair.
You guys keep this tight, right?
I was very angry and very upset. But the biggest thing is that I questioned my ability. I questioned my ability to coach. I questioned my knowledge. I questioned everything that I'd done up until that point. And it took me a long time to recognize that it wasn't something that I had not done or done. There were people that wanted something that I had, something that if I was still there, I was in the way, and that they couldn't possibly understand how to keep me involved. So Rugby Canada replaced me with John Tate, who great guy, great coach, nothing wrong with him. He is a former international rugby player, male. Basically, the entire coaching staff is male.
This is about power. This is what this is about. So when you talk about leadership and you talk about the power of the coach, the power of the ref, the power of the administrator, the sport governing body, our whole system offers power to men.
I think it's going to be a tough and long road for women in sport leadership, whether it's coaching or administration or officiating, because there has been some backsliding.
There are fewer women now in positions of decision making or as coaches or as officials in Canada at every level than there were 20 years ago.
Almost every university has something on gender equity, but you look at our university stats, we're the same. We're around 13% women coaches at the university level. UBC has 3 women coaches out of 28 sports.
Et même ici dans mon université, on a une femme entraîneur-chef. Une. Je pense qu'on est une des pires là, au Québec, au Canada. Fait que j'ai plus de cheveux, c'est pour ça. J'ai plus de cheveux.
So at some point, do you just go in and say, this is not okay? That we have to have quotas, it has to be on an annual basis, and you have to have a plan that it's not going to be 40 years from now and we're still kind of where we are now. We will have a Title IX kind of approach to this, where women's teams get the same money as men and that we ensure we have coaches coming through.
I think the changes that need to occur in sport are systemic. I think Sport Canada has initiated some women in leadership policy in place. Looks great on paper, but what are the action items from that?
En 2009, on a la nouvelle politique canadienne femmes et sport qui est sortie. Personne n'a entendu parler. Personne. Alors si on met une belle politique, mais que les gens peuvent, ils s'en occupent pas. Alors moi, je suis vraiment rendue au point où dire, je suis Sport Canada, tu veux de l'argent, montre-moi qu'il y a 40% de femmes sur ton conseil d'administration. T'as pas 40%, t'as pas d'argent. Ben, ça bouge.
I do think it's important to have female coaches because we're dealing with female athletes. And no matter how you slice it, a female is different than a male. It's not better, it's not worse, it's just different. Unless somebody can take a female brain and put it in a male and they can feel everything and understand everything, no matter how you slice it, it's never going to be the same.
The power of having and seeing is essential. We have to have women in leadership roles so that other women know that they can aspire to do the same.
I think there's absolutely a connection to be made between opening up the sport world to more women coaches and the lessening of harassment and abuse from male coaches to female athletes. Absolutely. I mean, that's not rocket science.
In 2000, Sandra Kirby and Lorraine Greaves published the results of the first survey examining sexual abuse and harassment in sport.
The results of that study were shocking. More than 1 in 5 high-performance athletes or recently retired high-performance athletes in Canada had had sexual intercourse with a person in a position of authority over them in sport.
It wasn't just being sexually assaulted or engaging in a longer-term relationship with a coach, an authority figure. It was also having to endure everyday sexist atmospheres in locker rooms and in places of play.
From the study, it turned out that about 90% of the harassment and abuse that the people reported, the athletes reported, was between older males and younger females.
I often tell adults and friends of mine, like, your kids are in a sport and you drop them off. I would wait. I would see how the coach treats the athletes, because you hear a lot of stories of young people have been mistreated by coaches and different people, you know, verbally, and had taking a long time to get over it. The one thing your child should never leave sports feeling like is an abused person.
Winique Horn Miller is an Olympic water polo player, a Pan Am Games gold medal winner and Commonwealth Games bronze medalist. She knows firsthand how the relationship between coach and athlete can be intense, personal, and destructive.
When we went to the Olympics in 2000, we didn't accomplish what we put our minds out to accomplish, and it was a huge fallout. There was already abuse going on, amongst the coaching staff, amongst players, but it was somewhat manageable, like verbal abuse. But then following it, it got worse and it was unmanageable and it was becoming really, really bad. I remember watching him, you know, tell one player in a game, you know, I'm gonna cut your head off, send it home to your mother, and they'll understand because you're just too stupid to understand what I'm trying to tell you. Like, it's a lot of stuff like that. Following the Olympics, I remember her putting her head on my shoulder saying, you know, I feel like an abused woman. I thought it all would be worthwhile once we won our medal. And I thought, that's not how sports should be, that you should endure horrific treatment in the hopes of a medal. Like, a medal is a medal. Like, it's an experience you should love.
Complaints about the coach's behavior led Water Polo Canada to engage the Centre of Sport and Law at Brock University to investigate. Water Polo Canada published their report and terminated the coach's contracts.
They were fired, but my sport's small, and my career didn't last much longer. Not even a year after I was kicked off, my reputation following the Olympics just went from being the golden girl of Water Polo Canada, of Sport Canada, everywhere, putting me up, oh, look at this native athlete, da, 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 sell the sport. And then afterwards, I was like, I was pretty much called everything in the book. A whore, this, that, and it was awful.
Winique had been told she was a team cohesion problem, something that ran very much against her Aboriginal heritage.
I come from a long line of chiefs, war chiefs, and I was raised that if you're put in a position of leadership, you defend your people, and that's the way. And if you can't do it, then don't be a leader. And I defended them because that's how I was brought up and that's my culture. And so being told that I'm a team cohesion problem because I did that tells me that my culture is not appropriate for sport in Canada and that the way I was acting was not appropriate. And that's something I thought was wrong.
Winique and her lawyer, Clayton Ruby, met with Water Polo Canada in mediation with Sport Canada's alternative dispute resolution. While she didn't regain her position on the squad, there was a positive outcome. Water Polo Canada announced it was changing how it handled cultural issues in sport.
I really think that Water Polo Canada dropped the ball in how they managed us post-Olympics. The coaches, not bad people, they're not horrible people, but they were depressed and it came out in an abusive environment. Do I think Water Polo Canada is better for it? Absolutely. Absolutely. Do I think the fact they learned from that? For sure. And the current coach of the national team is a former teammate of mine, Joanne Bégin. Awesome woman. The best. And I think that she is a very amazing player to have played with. And I think she's going to take that team to where it needs to go. I hope I made change. I hope I made good change within sport. And I'm really honored to be asked to be back at the Pan Am Games because I was such a shit disturber. Like, I really, really was. I was a shit disturber. Abuse can always happen if we're not vigilant. It takes everybody. And it takes everybody saying, you know, the one goal that we should have at the end of my child's career as a high-performance athlete or even whatever athlete their career takes them, they should come out feeling empowered and stronger, not weaker and abused.
Making girls feel stronger and more empowered is what sports should be about. But statistics are showing that many young people are dropping out of sports. Boys, yes, but girls in much greater numbers.
I find that it's just like, I see girls who I play sports with since I was young, and they suddenly reach the age of like a teenager, and they get really insecure about how they look and what they're doing, they stop. And it gets me just really sad and frustrated, because you have all that talent, and then you're just letting it go to waste. And it's not like sports make you look bad or anything. There's a lot more pressure for girls to be like, oh, I want a boyfriend, or oh, I want all these people to look at me. When you do sports, you get like a lot of muscle. You have abs, and then you have like leg muscle, and you have arm muscle. And some guys are intimidated by that, for sure, and they think it's like not as attractive as someone who's really skinny and has an hourglass shape. But it, honestly, when someone, like a guy, likes you for who you are, it's a lot more rewarding, yeah.
For girls, I think there definitely is issues around their body.
I would love to meet a girl between that age of 12 and 17 that does not have any insecurity, because she would be my hero.
For a lot of girls, there's this sense of lack, loss of freedom that comes with puberty, feeling like they're becoming women and they're not ready to become women yet. And it deters them from a place that they could be benefiting so much, right? A place where they could be free and uninhibited and aggressive and competitive and all of these things that are also very natural for girls and women to be.
My passion is how can I help to encourage Canada become more like a sporting nation and understand the power of sport. For example, right now I have gotten involved with Fit Spirit. So Fit Spirit is an organization about promoting physical activity and the power of sports to girls between that age of 12 and 17.
Cette année, on a visité plus de 160 écoles secondaires à travers le Québec et l'Ontario. On parle à peu près de 20 000 filles, ce qui est immense. Et tout de suite après, on enchaîne avec un programme d'entraînement qui est offert dans l'école secondaire pendant 10 semaines. Donc, elles sont toutes prêtes quand elles ont fini le plan qui les amène vers le 5-10 km et c'est là la grosse célébration.
I like the idea that Fit Spirit had targeted this group 12 to 17, which we know are at the greatest risk of dropping out of sports and being involved in physical activity. And if you drop out at that age group, you're more likely to be sedentary for the rest of your life. And guess what comes along with that? All the health issues that you don't want to happen. So in my mind, I'm like, okay, these girls can walk out of this program and say, you know what, I'm gonna continue to do this. And each year they keep running another 5K or 10K and they're tracking their time. What did I do the first time I ran it, the second time? And now all of a sudden we've created a lifetime runner who now embodies the idea of being physically active and having a healthy lifestyle. That's huge.
Way to go, guys. I hope that my daughters never stop playing sport. I think that it profoundly changes you as a woman. I think that sport connects you to your physical body in such a meaningful way, where you begin to experience your body as strong and resilient and capable. You conduct yourself in life, really, from that place of strength.
We bring in these young athletes who all their life as girls have been told, you know, be nice, be gentle, don't hurt each other, you know, don't fight, don't do this. And now they're given the opportunity to not fight, but just use their body and be proud of the fact that they're strong, be proud of the fact that they're fit and they have muscle and they work out, and it's a good thing.
It's not just about staying fit, it's a suicide preventer, it's a pregnancy preventer, it is a joining gangs preventer, it is a murdered and missing women preventer. Like, it's so important.
There's nothing that I can think of that prepares you, I think, for life's challenges than being involved in sport, and I speak from my own experience. But if, you know, you don't have a focus and you don't have something that you can sort of hang your hat on and be confident about that lifts you up and rises you up, I think you can get caught up in a lot of things that are not productive in life. And it really, sport builds you from the inside out, and it makes you who you are going to be for the rest of your life. And I think that's really important for girls.
Sport for girls and women is slowly changing. We have corporate campaigns celebrating female athletes, initiatives dedicated to keeping girls in sport, and primetime commercials that challenge the perception women are either too weak or too sexy for sport. But is this enough? What will it take to make substantial and sustainable change? And who is going to lead the charge?
We often hear that, where's the next generation, where are their voices? First of all, their voices are very different than our voices. The young women that are coming through are not insecure. They believe they have a right to be in the world, and they have a right for their share of the world. So I think there will just be those kinds of asks going forward, saying enough is enough. You can't have the policies and not implement them. And the numbers of people you can gather to bring about change will be huge.
Et c'est sûr que pour moi, c'est facile, là, chialer, mais je suis une femme d'action, puis je veux que ça bouge. C'est quoi je fais? Je veux être capable de leur donner des solutions, des pistes d'action très concrètes dans des environnements qui contrôlent. Alors, on n'est pas C'est sûr que demain matin, on n'aura pas 50 % de femmes entraîneurs. Mais j'espère que dans 10 ans, oui, on va l'avoir.
It's taking a lot of leaders, a lot of women pushing the boundaries and really having to push to break down barriers of that old school, you know, thought process of women aren't as strong, they're not as fast, they're not as skilled. I want to see more women taking charge of who they are within sport, and I want to see more federations allow that door to be open, because there are chicks out there that will blast down those doors.